Welcome back to the final lecture in our series, Maple Leaf and Stars and Stripes. I'm going to keep this short and sweet because you're here to see Drew and not listen to me speak, and I'm really sick of doing these introductions, I must say. No, that was just a joke. I'm not serious. Okay. In any case, the first lecture, I was thinking about the first lecture, which started on Halloween, so tonight, it's not a trick, it's a treat. And I started off talking about the first lecture on Halloween, which was about vampires. I said that our speaker was no stranger to danger, so I'm going to call this one No Stranger to Danger Part 2. You see, supposedly, or theater has been called the most dangerous of all arts. If this is true, that would make the dramatist, or the playwright for that matter, the most dangerous of all artists. So I've brought a dangerous artist here into the lecture hall. I hope you're interested in that. And once again, we've had plenty of academic presentations, so it's time for something a little artsier. And what can I say about Drew? I think he can say most of it all by himself. So I'm basically going to say how I see Drew. He's basically a dabbler in a variety of literary genres, or as I like to call him, a literary shapeshifter. His latest novel is a trickster novel called Motorcycles and Sweetgrass. His latest produced play is actually a very sad tale with comic moments called God and the Indian, about a residential school survivor. And his latest project I find very interesting and intriguing. It is a collection of sci-fi short fiction, native sci-fi. How about that? Yeah. What else can I say? This lecture, the title of this lecture, Peeking Under the Loincloth, An Insider's Take on Native Sexuality. This was all a gigantic happy accident. And those of you who take creative writing with me know I've talked about happy accidents, things that happen that you don't expect. You see, I wrote to Drew, we need a sexy title for the lecture series. And he was probably so busy and stressed preparing his 3-week trip to India that he thought I wanted a lecture on sex. I didn't, I just wanted a sexy title. And look what we've got now, a lecture on Native Sexuality. One final word. He asked me, well, what are they expecting? I said, good question, it's a mixed bunch. I don't know. With you, one should always expect the unexpected. So let's see what awaits us. Welcome back, Drew Hayden Taylor.
As we say in my reserve, grazie. First things first, during Halloween on my reserve, we do not say trick or treat, we say trick or treaty. That's the quality you're going to get. I find it very encouraging that when a lecture on Native sexuality is announced, 3/4 of the audience are women. This is why Germany is one of my favorite countries. I just hope I can live up to the bill. And I was, just in order to frighten the ladies who are organizing this, I threatened to bring in a couple of anatomically correct dolls for demonstrations. And I was going to color one red. But I opted not to. Now, first of all, for those who give you a little bit of background on who I am and why I'm talking about this particular subject, for those who aren't familiar with my work, I'm what is referred to as one of those rare breeds of animals called a professional writer. That is to say, I do not have a day job, I do not spend my afternoon saying, would you like fries with this? As a writer, I work in many different fields and on a number of different topics. And my original area of focus was humor, but as we both know, humor and sex are interrelated, at least in my experience. Now, I'm from a small First Nations community in Central Ontario, a place called Curve Lake, and my sort of interest and experience in sex or the product of sex started before I was born, because As some of you heard when I lectured the other day, my mother, I come from both a big and a small family. My mother is the oldest of 14, and I'm told that comes from sex. And also from not having the internet. And another byproduct of sex is the fact that I also come from a small family. I'm an only child, which my mother blamed on the fact I was 11 pounds, 13 ounces. Again, the byproduct. Oh, and I can say I was also breech with no cesarean. growing up, and then, like, I grew up on the reserve until I was 18, and I went off into the big bad world of Toronto and the rest of Canada. And I began to sort of explore perceptions of Native people from all different angles. Because I grew up in a Native community looking the way I look, this is my 14th lecture tour of Germany, and as I've often said, people have told me I look more German than Native. And this is because my standard joke, I'm half Ojibway, half Caucasian, so that makes me an occasion. But growing up, I had identity. I grew up with sort of a unique view of identity and what being Native meant, and what, more importantly, what other people thought of Native people. Because I would pass in a crowd in Toronto, and I would hear things, or I would bring up topics to cab drivers, and I would hear what the Canadian perception of Native people was. And this included everything from politics right down to sexuality. And my original area of focus that I do a lot of writing about was humor. And I ended up, because of this perception of Native people by both the dominant and non-dominant cultures of Canada, the fact that, you know, the tragic Indian, the sad Indian, the alcoholic Indian, the disappearing Indian, all these stories of the sort of the negative, dysfunctional aspect of the Native community was very prevalent. And I decided, because I have been very fortunate to have traveled to over 130 Native communities across Canada and the United States, I knew this was a falsehood. I knew what a great sense of humor we had. So I decided to go out and battle that perception of Native people through a number of things. One, I wrote a lot of Native humor that celebrated and explored Native humor. Secondly, I directed a documentary for the National Film Board of Canada, a documentary on Native humor called Redskins, Tricksters, and Puppy Stew. And then based on that, I decided there's so much more to be covered that could be covered in a 54-minute documentary that I ended up editing and compiling a book exploring and deconstructing Native humor called Me Funny. Because as I said, I wanted to go out and shift that perception of what the dominant culture thought of Native people. We knew we were funny, but nobody else did. So after that book came out, and I finished with that, it did very well, got a good response, and I think it was like a positive contribution to the material that was being produced about Native people, that I thought, well, what else needs to be explored about the Native culture from both our perspective, the perspective of both Native people and non-Native people. What other perception of Native people needs to be revised, revisited, and perhaps altered? And then it came to me, Native sexuality. And I say this primarily because if you looked at the primary information in the media about Native people, there were basically three forms. One, high rates of STDs in the Native community, dead Native prostitutes or missing Native prostitutes, and high levels of sexual abuse from residential schools. That was basically it. So it was all dark and depressing, yet we have the highest birth rate of any culture in Canada, so there must be something fun about it. In fact, 50% of the Native people in Canada are under 25. Right? So needless to say, as I said, there must be something fun about it, and let's go out and figure out what the heck is going on here. So I decided to do a similar book that I'd done to my book on Native humor, which was called Me Funny. So I decided to do a book called Me Sexy. Which, as I said, was an exploration and deconstruction of the sexual Aboriginal. And I guess I could say I had to go out and do a lot of research. And more importantly, you should have seen the look on my accountant's face when I brought in all the receipts. Or, excuse me, could I have a receipt for that? So in doing this, I tried to look at the topic from as many different angles, from how Native people perceive sexuality and how non-Native perceive Native sexuality. Now, what you also have to keep in mind is, for obvious reasons, at time of contact in 1497, there are over 50 separate languages and dialects spoken in Canada. So there is no one Native presence. There is no one Native nation. There's no Native one Native language or anything. We are all separate people with separate perceptions, separate customs and belief systems. That's like saying, you know, how many languages and dialects are there spoken in Europe? Europe is not one people or one nation. Because we have people who live along the coast who are salmon people. We have people in the Arctic, people in the mountains, people in the prairies. So they all have different ways of approaching and celebrating different aspects of their Native culture, and sexuality is just one of them. So, as I said, doing one documentary and one book on the topic was kind of ambitious, but you have to start somewhere. So, So the only representation of Native sexuality was essentially bad. And my fear when I was doing the stuff on Native humor was the fact that in the end we were beginning to believe the publicity ourselves, that we were that all this stuff was true. And you get to a point where you have to stand up and say it isn't. And one of the first examples I came across of this was an art exhibit that was put together about 15 years ago in Brandon, Manitoba. This art curator, Native art curator, noticed that in several different parts of the country there were various very prominent and skilled and well-respected artists that would occasionally do visual or installation art dealing with Native sexuality. And so she decided to curate an exhibit on Native sexuality in an art gallery in Brandon that later went to Ottawa and then Brantford, and it was called Exposed. Now the interesting thing about quote Native sexuality, and again I'm using the broad term when I've just told you there's no one thing, humor me for the moment. The interesting thing about Native sexuality is it has been filtered through Christianity. Basically the perceptions that were existing in many Native communities were split down the middle and also blended, where there's a perception of sexuality through what the church would teach them. So there was this sort of belief that, again, homosexuality was evil, any obvious or prominent form of sexuality was bad, all these different things that the priest had told them. Because traditionally, in almost every Native culture, homosexuality was actually a positive thing, if you want to believe it. Whereas most of our medicine men and spiritual leaders were gay or lesbian, because they had the body of one and the spirit of the other. So they were a whole person. So oftentimes, as I said, it was our medicine men and spiritual leaders who were gay and lesbian. But then you had the introduction of the church that came in and sort of introduced the concept that, no, it's not. So today, many Native communities are rapidly homophobic because of that. And now we're in this time where we're switching back to the way it was, to showing the equality and the importance of that alternative lifestyle. Now, oh, just a minute now, where was I going with all that? I'm going all over the place here. Sorry?
Can we make suggestions?
Only if you act them out. So in today's world, right, one of the interesting things about major cities like Toronto or Montreal or Vancouver is, like, Toronto is often referred to as the largest reserve in Canada. There's over 80,000 Native people living in Toronto. And and within the artistic community of all over the community, there's a sizable chunk of gay and lesbians living within that, because again, they have been forced out by this whole thing. And I've known people like, and what's interesting is the people who are sort of embracing traditional beliefs have sort of brought over that philosophy cloaked in beads and feathers. Because I knew this one Native poet, she was a grandmother, she would go to these ceremonies, but she was a really like hip grandmother, where she would wear leather skirts knee length. And what is mandatory when you go to traditional ceremonies to wear ankle length dresses. And she's a well-respected grandmother, well-respected poet, but when she would go to these things, she would be chewed out by people because she wore knee-high leather skirts. And she had trouble trying to deal with that because, as I said, she was a grandmother, led a good life, all these different things, but these people who did not know were passing judgment on her just because of the size of her, the length of her skirt, which was a respectable length. So in terms of doing the research for this book, right, using that as an example of the type of attitudes that were prevalent out there in the community. He's stealing my spirit. Now, one of the ways this was also very prevalent that had entered our art, was through one of my areas of expertise is theater. When I got started in theater, I decided to try and get myself familiar with as much different kinds of Native theater as I could, because I didn't know that much about it, and it was just starting out. It was a new brand of art form. One of my standard comments is, most of us believe the contemporary Native literary renaissance began in 1986, November 22nd, 8 p.m. The wind was out of the east. That's when a play called The Rest Sisters opened in Toronto and revolutionized the larger Canadian theatrical community. And bang, all these people were writing plays from the Native community and about the Native community. And so I was new, I'd never written a play before, never taken a theater course. I remember going into Native Earth, where I was the writer in residence, taking out a stack of the plays that had been produced or were being considered and reading them, and going to every Native play I could find. And I noticed something really interesting. The dominant metaphor in almost every play that was written from the mid-80s to the mid-90s was rape. If you're familiar with Rest Sisters, Dry Lips, and almost everything else going forth, there's a rape in almost every Native play. There are exceptions. I didn't really put any in mine, and I don't think Daniel David Moses had any in his. But that's just the only two exceptions that come to my mind. Now, the reason for this being that, you know, art should reflect life or should reflect existence. And most Native cultures from across Canada were either partly matriarchal, matrilineal, or had strong female representations in the preservation and maintenance of the culture, or were completely matriarchal or matrilineal, like many of the West Coast tribes or the Iroquois. And then you have the introduction of the European church and government, which were largely patriarchal. So basically, the best metaphor that generation of Native writers could come up with to best describe what happened to the Native population as a whole was rape. And all these plays come out, and everyone had a rape. There's one play out called Night of the Trickster that I think had 6 or 7 rapes in it. And at the risk of sounding disrespectful, as with people who were watching it, and about the time the 4th or 5th rape came on, we all sort of went, oh, another rape. And I remember having lunch with a friend of mine who was an actress who was working on this one play, and we were having lunch, and she seemed kind of down and kind of depressed. A dog! We have two dogs?
Two dogs in the audience.
Woof. That's Ojibway for bow wow. So I was having lunch with this actress friend of mine who was working on this play, and she seemed kind of down, kind of just depressed, and I said, what's wrong? And she said, oh, it's this play I'm working on. And I said, what's wrong? And she goes, oh, It's very tiring being raped 7 times a week. Twice on Sundays. So as I said, I just think there's got to be so much more to the Native culture than just rape. But that was where the mindset was at this time, because a lot of these Native writers were women and they were men, but that was on their mind, basically standing up and saying, this is what happened to our culture, to our people, and to our women. So that was the wave of expression coming out at that time. And this, and as I was saying earlier, this exhibit that came out called Exposed. The woman who was putting it together was concerned that because of that influence of the Christian church in many communities, there's a certain conservatism and reticence when it comes to publicly displaying any form of Native sexuality. So she was very, very concerned, and she did what a lot of Native people do when they're concerned. She went and consulted an elder from a nearby reserve, and she brought her in to look at the exhibit, all this art, installation, and visual that dealt with Native sexuality. And she said, am I doing something wrong? Should I cancel the exhibit? And the elder said to her, no, it's about time you young people reclaimed our sexuality. And so the exhibit went through, and it became actually quite a large thing. I think there's been one or two more exhibits of that kind in the last 15 years. Not only that, there's been a book of Native erotica come out, published by Kattery Akwenzie Dam, if you don't say press, that deals with erotica written in New Zealand, Australia, Hawaii, the States, and Canada by Indigenous authors about Indigenous sexuality. So, using a bad metaphor, the cat is out of the bag. Now, when I was doing my research, right, I as you can tell, I travel all over the place. 2 months ago, I was in Spain. 1 month ago, I was in India, and now I'm here. And I do more across Canada, again, lecturing on Native sexuality, Native humor, Native literature, etc. And I always keep my eyes and ears open to things that were happening that might impact on either Native sexuality or the larger issue of sexuality. And there were some really funny and interesting bits I came across. Like, for instance, the concept of escort services. Do you have escort services here in Germany?
Yeah.
I remember going to one, and what I would do is, when I was in my hotel room, I would get out the phone book and look up escort services. I don't know if here people remember what a Yellow Pages is. Way before you went online. And I'd be just sitting there, like I said, killing time, because I'd make notes. I was working on half a dozen different projects at any one time. So I'd make notes, and it was very, very interesting, the stuff you would find. Now, speaking about just, because I wanted to get a baseline of what the dominant culture's view of sexuality was, as well as our own. So in terms of the whole thing of the escort service, places like, I love Montreal. In Montreal, they had an escort service called room service, because when the bill showed up on your credit card, it would say room service. One of my other favorite ones was actually in Toronto, and this is actually quite a sad one. There was an escort service called Discount Escorts. And I don't know a lot about the social hierarchy of the escort service, but me working, hi, I'm your discount escort. You've got to be sad. My favorite was in a town called Saskatoon in Saskatchewan. I don't remember the name of the company, but basically in the ad it said, be sure and ask about our hunter's special. It's in northern Saskatchewan, so they do a lot of hunting there. So I'm sitting there trying to figure out what a hunting special is. They'll gut and clean your deer while she's there. They'll get a box of shotgun shells as a gift. I don't know. Now the other interesting thing I came across was I was exploring. I was doing research with the concept of strippers. And what I found was really interesting, right? It's not so much the whole stripping angle, but it's the difference between male and female strippers, right? Female strippers would come out, and they wouldn't particularly accentuate the fact that they were Native, because let's face it, in a strip club with women strippers, I don't think men look above the collarbone. So it doesn't really matter if she's native or not. But what's interesting with male strippers, they come out as a native stripper. Because women want the image. They want the fantasy. That's why they have the cop, the fireman, all these different men who come out as a character. They want the character. So I came across male native strippers who would come out as the warrior. Why is that, Priya?
Cover of your book.
True, true, true. Not only that, right? That was one of the sort of interesting little things about that. Why women want the whole package? If you've ever noticed this, women go nuts at a strip bar. Men just sit there, catatonic. It's really bizarre. But I was also doing research at that time too on magazines and porn films, right? And talking about buying the whole image, right? I came across this one magazine called Blue Boy. It was a gay skin magazine, right? So on the cover was this picture of this really good-looking native guy, long hair blowing in the wind. He's got a bone choker, white shirt with a vest, breech cloth, and he's in, you know, knee-high grass blowing. He's standing there like this. And the title below it said, Indian Summer, Hung Like Crazy Horse. Hey, you wanted to hear this. Now, also, during the early and mid-90s, with the success of Dance of the Wolves, the American pop culture industry became infatuated, however briefly, with anything to do with Native culture. You know, these Native stories began appearing in all these sort of television shows and whatever. And if you can believe it, even the American porn industry became briefly fascinated with Native culture and started to do Native-themed porn. And I managed to find two unique titles. And I forgive me, these are kind of graphic, I apologize. But I didn't write them, shoot them, direct them, or star them. I found one that was called Poke a Hot Ass. And the other one, this is worse, are you there? Grab your seat. Geranimal. And the byline underneath the title said, he's known for sneaking up from behind. I'm sure some of you are wondering, is this worth my Thursday night? Now, of course, a lot of this came, it didn't start, this popular dominant culture interest in Native sexuality, Native romance, whatever, didn't just start with Dance with Wolves or any of that stuff. It goes way back. I mean, I'm sure people here have read Winnetou and all that, and I remember I read the first Winnetou book, and I have to say, I found it exceedingly homoerotic. There's a story underneath the subtext that's just waiting to burst forward. So. But there was also something in there about, what is it, Winnetou's sister falling in love with old Shatterhand, but he wouldn't have anything to do with her because she was a savage. Now, there's this whole subgenre of romance novels, you know, historical romance novels, bodice rippers, where all these white women fall in love with Indian guys back in the late 1800s, get swept off the prairies and right off into the sunset, so to speak. And I wrote about that, and I'd like to read you a bit of this, if I may. This is from my collection of humorous articles and essays I did. The first one, which was a series of essays about identity, was based on something people used to say to me all the time: "Funny, you don't look like one." The second book, the sequel, was called "Funny, you don't look like one too." So I'm going to read you an article, and it's called "How to Make Love to an Aboriginal Without Sexually Appropriating Him or Her." It wasn't too long ago when Lee Miracle, the well-known Native writer turned actress, and I were having a lively conversation at a downtown watering hole. The subject at hand, the exciting growth and expansion of Native literature, something we both have a familiarity with. In recent years, there have been many inroads made and directions explored by Native writers hitherto unseen. We have produced biographies, comic adventures, dramatic novels, searing political attacks, and a plethora of theatrical plays. But we also noted that there were still a few avenues of expression that had not been as of yet tested. Erotica, for some known reason, sprung to our minds. Pooling our experiences, we both had come across a few poems in some theater that bordered on the erotic, but other than those few samples, the pickings were pretty lean in that department. And knowing that nature hates a vacuum, not to mention two writers in search of a good idea, we toyed with the idea of co-editing a book of Native erotica. Not to be confused with Native neurotica, of course. Between the two of us, we knew we could put together the finest samples of literary love Native writers had to offer. Page upon page of pounding pulses, sweaty skin, heaving bosoms. Why should white people have all the fun? The closest I had ever come to the concept of Native erotica was a book of so-called erotic legends I had read as a teenager, called Tales from the Smokehouse. It featured a series of amorous adventures with such characters as Big Arrow. It was narrated by men in a sweat lodge. Compiled and written by a white writer, some of the tales had a decidedly contemporary setting and feel. The more we talked about our little project, the more excited we became. First, we had to discuss what the parameters of the collection would be. Specifically, how would we define Native erotica? What separates our erotica from other types of erotica? My argument was the real difference between the two was that in Native erotica, there were no tan lines. However, the former journalist and me saw the need to research this properly before the writing could take place. Some have argued that one type of Native erotica, stories about Natives, not by Natives, is already alive and well and available at your local bookstore. Much like Tales from the Smokehouse, non-Native writers have tapped into the lust-filled Aboriginal angle long before Lee and I have come up with our hot and heavy little idea. Visit the historical romance department of any substantial bookstore and you'll see an amazing selection of literature that features a magnificent Native man, well-muscled, dressed in a taunt laced buckskin breechcloth, and always leaning at a 45-degree angle, with a mane and breast-blessed woman, almost always fiery and independent and white, that is willing to loosen the ties that bind, if you know what I mean. Here's a random but true sampling of what I found. Wild Thunder by Casey Edwards. "You have come to see the horses," Strong Wolf said. Suddenly, alone with him, his night black eyes stirred her inside so pleasurably. Hannah went to him, framing his face between her trembling hands, hardly able to believe that she could be so bold, so reckless. She brought his lips to her. When his arms pulled her against his iron-hard body, his head swam with the ecstasy of the moment. Strong Wolf whispered against her lips, "You want to see the horses now?" His fingers stroked her back. The heat of his touch reached through the thin fabric of her cotton gloves. "Later," Anna whispered back, her voice unfamiliar to her in its huskiness. Strong Wolf whisked her up into his arms and held her close as their eyes met in the unspoken passion. He kicked the door shut and then kissed her feverishly as he carried her towards his bed. An awful lot of whispering going on. I was going to whisper more. And why do they always have names like Strong Wolf, never anything like John, Ted, or Herbie, or
group.
And there, for a brief while, how many people here know who Fabio is? How is everybody? Fabio had his own line of romance novels for a while. I think, obviously, ghostwritten. So here's one called Comanche by Fabio. She was tired of fighting him. She curled her arms around his neck and let herself succumb only a little to the potent feeling White Wolf's nearness aroused. He trailed warm kisses down her jaw, the curve of her neck. Then she felt his hot breath and wet lips tickling her. Maggie moaned softly. She had never known such a rapport could exist. The intensity of the pleasure racked her with chills. With a devastating urgency, her resistance faded. Maggie felt free of her shadow of control, her heart hammering, her flesh crying out for her husband's heed. She mused that she might be out of her mind, and she was in the arms of a wild, totally aroused savage, determined to have her. Strong Wolf and White Wolf, they must be brothers. The Wolf brothers, they live just on the block. Sounds like Hannah and Maggie could be related too. It seems they both have a fondness for totally aroused savages, but then who doesn't? Song of a Warrior by Georgina Gentry. Passions flamed. Green eyes, you're too innocent to know what may happen if I stay. Her heart skipped a beat. She was playing with fire, and like a small child, suspecting the danger, but was too fascinated by the flame to back away while there was still time. Her whole being seemed controlled by heat, and she couldn't control her words. Don't go, she said again. With a muttered curse, Bear turned and swept her into his embrace. Holding her close against his powerful body, Willow knew she couldn't stop him now, even if she wanted to. She was horrified when she realized she didn't want him to. Another typical day in the reserve. Bear and Willow at it again, sweeping and embracing everywhere. I tried sweeping and embracing once. The woman thought I was going for a purse. I couldn't walk properly for a week. Shawnee Moon by Judith E. French. When his Shawnee mother died, handsome half-breed Sterling Gray left the noble tribe that raised him and crossed an ocean to become a British soldier and gentleman. Now he's returning to his homeland with a breathtaking new bride, a Scottish hellion wearing an ancient Celtic necklace, whom he rescued from a hangman's noose. Those very presents inflames Caitlin's heart with a vengeful fire. Sterling knows the dangerous beauty is his destiny. A love foretold in mystic visions, a love for which he must risk his passions, his pride, and his future to win. I'm a half-breed. I've been to England. Actually, it was 3 hours at the Heathrow Airport, but it was still England. Yet for the life of me, I don't remember running across any Scottish hellions during my breakfast. It must have been an off day for them. Anyway, that gives you an idea of what I'm doing. So, when I was doing this book, we decided to go with that formula. And so, the book that I was doing, as I said, it's a follow-up to Me Funny. So I decided to do a book called Me Sexy. And yes, that is me on the cover, before the accident. And just want to read you the subtitle here. It says, Me Sexy. He was silent but strong, from an untamed land where love and buckskin walked a sensual path. She was pale and virginal, unversed in the ways of Aboriginal passion. Her heart beat wildly as he moved towards her, because the night was dark, and so was he. Now, when we were putting this together, and I saw the cover, I just loved it. And I was talking with the publisher, and they were saying, it's obviously representative of those romance novels I mentioned. She said, "Why don't you write something that?" Like an Aboriginal version of what I just read, like a little blurb to put on the back of the book. And I thought that was such a good idea that I decided to write one, much in the same vein as what you just heard. So this is my version. But I want to know more about your people, how they love and make love. Her creamy white bosom rose and fell a little more quickly as she asked this daring question. His eyes, lit by the campfire, could not or would not find his in the evening darkness.
You might not like what you find, he finally answered, his voice as hard as his body. It is a privilege we reserve for a select few. Are you strong enough for such a journey? The flames danced off his naked torso as he fed more wood onto the fire. Part of her was afraid of the passion this Aboriginal man aroused in her, but another part craved what he could teach her. But she was no child, she was a woman, and he was a man. Her voice quivered as she answered, "Teach me." And he did. To creamy white bosoms. So what this book is it's a series of 13 essays on various aspects of Native sexuality. Everything from art to traditional storytelling to a whole bunch of different things. But what I found really interesting was sort of the personal stories that came up. You heard me mention Lee Miracle, who's a very well-known author, activist, feminist, just a very powerful woman who's my pleasure to know. And she told this great story that during the 70s, when she was just a young girl, I love telling this, because when she was an older teenager in Vancouver in the late 60s, and I don't know how many of the young people will know this term, but the older people will, she was a go-go dancer in a cage. If you remember those old, everybody who's seen Austin Powers, right? Like those things, where there's these cages and these discos, and there'd be women dancing in boots and skirts and to the music. And she was young and beautiful and hot and just sort of trying to make money by dancing in a cage. And then as she got older, she got more political. And she was at some big Native political meeting in Saskatoon, I think Regina, in the early 70s. And she got there, and she was doing something, talking about the youth participating and changing the world, that type of thing. And afterwards, when she got down, this Cree elder came up to her, and he was a very well-known, respected elder from Saskatchewan. And she was like in her earlier mid 20s, and they're chatting, and he said to her, and you said some really important things up there. I can feel your passion. I think what you're doing is very good, but I think every time you do this, you should consider how you dress. You should dress the way your elders would want you to dress, because and much like the other person I told you about, she was like in a mini skirt, boots, shirt. No, this was the era of no bras, all that sort of stuff. And so this elder, I was telling her, I think you should dress the way your elders want you to dress, and she went, "Oh, okay." And she took her top off. Because traditionally, the Salish women in summer would go around topless. It was just cooler. And there's no record of what the old man said, how he responded. In Thompson Highway, oh, God bless Thompson. In my first book, Me Funny, he gave me an essay on why Cree is the funniest language ever created. And in the second book, Me Sexy, he gave me an essay on why Cree is the sexiest language ever created. And he basically goes in to describe, he's trilingual, speaks three languages, English, French, and Cree. And he describes how English is the language of the brain, of the mind, of the intellect, that when you're talking about something in English, you're breaking it down, you're deconstructing it, you're taking it apart and putting it back together. That's the English language. And he says in French is the language of the heart and the stomach. When you're talking about food, you taste the food. When you're talking about wine, you taste the wine. When you're talking about love, you're falling in love. So it's the language of the heart and the stomach. And he says, Cree comes from below the stomach. And then he said it goes in to describe how almost anything in Cree can sound dirty. those wacky Cree people. Trying to catch up here. Now the interesting thing, sexually, there's this whole political movement that's happening in Canada because of all this. Because it's a total moment of flux and going back and forth, that the whole sexuality issue in many cases has been a product of the Indian Act in Canada and a problem with the dominant culture. I don't know how familiar people are here with Bill C-31 and all that, but sort of the division and the importance of sexes came down to that, that it used to be, up until 1986, if a white woman married a native guy, she would become native. But if a native woman married a white guy, she would lose her status and become white and would be kicked off the reserve. So this happened for like, you know, ever since Indian Act, for over 100 years. And so there's this whole group of native women who had been married, divorced, whatever, who were kicked off the reserve and barred from coming back. Yet all these white women who had become native and got to live on a reserve and got some of the benefits of living on a reserve. And there's a few cases of some reserves in Canada where, because they were native now, they got a status card like I have, they actually ran for chief and won. So some reserves had a white woman. And needless to say, a lot of native women had problems with this. And actually, they went to the United Nations Human Rights Court, and they said, yeah, that's not fair. And it went all through the Human Rights Commission in Canada until in 1986, Bill C-31 happened, which basically made everything status quo. Basically, white woman marries a native guy, she stays white. Native woman marries a white guy, she stays native. And the first generation of the children are native, regardless. And so there's been this big influx of native women and their kids trying to get their status back. But you can do that, you apply it and you get your status back. But the problem being, a lot of native communities are getting like a 20 to 40% increase in population, but no increase in budget. So as a result, there's a certain, in some communities, a certain animosity towards all these people coming back and straining the sort of environment. So this has sort of set off this whole big counterculture problem. One time I was lecturing at the University of Alberta in Edmonton, and I walked in and I had just come from a flight somewhere. They picked me up at the airport. I was there with a suitcase. I was tired, I was hungry. I had to do this interview at a radio station before I went to do a book launch or a reading. And so I get ushered in to do this live radio interview at the university, and this native woman had the, it was doing it live, and I get ushered in, and they give me a cup of coffee, and I sit down, I'm just exhausted, but I perk myself up, because I want to be good, I want to give a good interview, and I'm sitting there, and the first question she asks me is, Drew, why is it that native men, when they reach a certain level of success and affluence, always end up dating and marrying white women? So all of a sudden, out of nowhere, I'm a spokesperson for every native man in Canada. And I start like hemming and hawing, going, this is live, right? And I'm like, suddenly I have to. So I start, you know, verbally tap dancing. And I say, you tend to always sort of date and marry people within your socioeconomic group, and there's more white people than native people, and in terms of successful people, there's more successful white people than native people, so you tend to date married people that you associate with in your socioeconomic group. And then I just got annoyed. And then I said, or could be just simply white women are easier to find in the dark. I think she learned not to ask me questions like that anymore. Now, one of the interesting little side notes of combining my two projects, as I said, humor and sexuality, was dealing with native humor. Because native humor is a form of survival humor. It's filtered through 500 years of colonization, of reserves, of boarding school, that it has several different functions. As all survival humor is, it's protective, and it's also barbed and prickly. And it serves that function within the community. So as a result, native humor is very, very politically incorrect. But within the native community, it's like, we know that, we understand that, but people outside the native community sort of think, you know, is that really the attitude? But one of the dominant factors of native humor is the concept of self-deprecatory. We love to make fun of ourselves as an individual, as a nation, or all nations. So we have whole...
Hello.
What the heck is that? That's to tell me the lecture's over? ending with a bang. So how am I doing for time here?
Another 5 to 10 minutes, and then we have to reserve some time for questions.
I'll end up with the jokes. As I said, our humor is very politically incorrect, and oftentimes people from outside the community think that we are that it's being disrespectful. But you know, within this, in my book on Native humor, I talk about the sphere of influence. That people within the community hear the jokes, they understand that it's often a reaction to the outside world more than a comment on the interior world. And I'll give you some examples of some sexual humor. That when I talk to Native people, they laugh, but without the explanation, I've had people say, you know, what are you, a misogynist? And it's like, I don't write these jokes. I collected them for my book on Native humor. As I hide behind the table. As I said, keep in mind, these are politically incorrect for a reason. They're survival humor. A band office, for those who don't know, it's like the city hall on a reserve. It's where the chief council and all the government programs are administered through. So here, one of the jokes is, what do you call 50 band office employees and 50 lesbians? It's 100 people who don't do dick. maybe I should stop. No, but I'll give you an example of one joke that when I was doing Me Funny, I spent a year collecting Indian jokes from all over the world, all over Canada and the States, because I wanted it to be a book not only of Native humor, book about Native humor, but of Native humor. And there was this one joke I got that my editor strongly disagreed with and ended up leaving the project because of it. And she was a woman. So this is the joke, and I'm curious to see if you find this objectionable. This Native man and this minister are out for a walk one day, and what is happening is the minister is teaching the Native guy how to speak English. So they spend the day doing this. They walk up and say, this is a stone, can you say stone? Native guy says, stone. This is a tree, can you say tree? Native guy says, tree. Those are clouds. Can you say clouds? Clouds. So they do this all day until they're down by the river. And then he says, this is a river. Can you say river? And the Native guy goes, river. And as they're walking up from the river, they go through some bulrushes. And in the bulrushes, they see a man and a woman having sex. And the minister gets all flustered and embarrassed and says, man riding a bicycle. And the Native guy takes out his bow and arrow and shoots them, killing them both by putting an arrow through them. And the minister is all shocked and surprised and steps back and goes, well, why did you do that? And the Native guy goes, man riding my bicycle. Now, my editor had a problem with that. Because she thought it was a joke that advocated violence against women. Because he put an arrow, because he killed her. He also killed him.
Yes.
Now, when we're talking about this, and this is her terminology, she said, yes, I know I'm a well-educated, middle-class white lesbian, but I feel I cannot allow this joke to go out in a book I have edited or it will anger my sisters. So we went back and forth on this, and she even suggested, well, why don't you change the gender? Why don't you make it a minister and a Native woman? And I mean, if you go through your joke in your head, I guess it would work, but it still comes down to the same thing. She would have killed him, right? So killing a man is okay? So we ended up having this interesting sort of discussion, and I wanted to present sort of an unexpurgated, unedited version of Native humor for people to draw their own opinion. And she ended up displeased and left the project because of that one joke. And I will leave you with the final joke and open it up for discussion on Native sexuality. What do Native women say after great sex? Thanks, Drew.
Around him, and we discover that he was a white author writing cliched and stereotypical stories about Native people, and these characters did not want this continue being this, so one of them rose up and killed him. And they end up discovering the computer. One of the characters is a character named Billy Jack, who's from a series of movies in the 70s. He was an ex-Vietnam Green Beret half-breed who was saving reserve. Anyways, because he comes from the 1970s, he knew what a typewriter was and he could figure out what a computer was, so they decide to rewrite their stories. In the second act, their stereotypes from contemporary Native literature, where they written by Native authors, because we've had a good, strong Native literary industry that we're now beginning to develop our own stereotypes. Now, there's a piece in here about Pocahontas that people seem to like. Let me just find it. Talk amongst yourselves.
That's my
turn. Yeah. Hold on.
She does.
Another joke. Yeah, here we go. All right, so I'm good. So basically, okay. So Pocahontas is talking with, kills many enemies as the bloodthirsty warrior. Injun Joe is the guy from, if you remember, your Tom Sawyer. He's the drunk half-breed. Billy Jack, and I think that's all you need to know. All right, so. So Pocahontas is talking about why she's rebelling against, they're all rebelling against their stereotypes, and they're trying to slowly find out why each of them are rebelling. Tonto, we thought you plenty respected. Pocahontas, by children maybe, but realistically, what have I got to be proud of? Do you know I'm actually 12 years old? By the way, for those who don't know this, Pocahontas was actually 12 or 13 when she met John Smith. And was known, one of the colonizers, people at the colony, wrote that she was also well known for doing nude cartwheels through the colony. Pocahontas, by children maybe, but realistically, what have I got to be proud of? You know, I'm actually 12 years old, kills many enemies. You carry it well. Pocahontas, I'm a 12-year-old running around with a 30-year-old sailor. No wonder my father wanted to kill him. And just Joe. She's 12 years old? Wow, what kind of corn do your people eat? Pocahontas, and let's not forget, I have been with the same man for what seems like forever. Billy Jack, actually more like 400 years if everything I suspect is true. Pocahontas, I'm 400 years old? Tonto, me don't usually run into many 400-year-old 12-year-olds. Pocahontas, 400 years old. No wonder we have nothing left to talk about. And after all that time I invest in John, he leaves me and goes back to England. Forget the little girl that gave him her heart. Typical of a man, isn't it? It's all so pointless. I have been stared at, fantasized about, romanticized, lusted after, and I've had to face it all with a smile, open arms, and even open legs. The novelty has worn off. I want out. Tonto, you sound plenty angry. Pocahontas, all you men are alike. Tonto, hey, you barking up wrong tree. Tonto's in a secret love relationship with the Lone Ranger. So, Tonto, hey, you barking up wrong tree. Tonto, and that son of a bitch was going to start it all over again. Another goddamn story about the little lovesick Indian princess. Damn it, you'd think these male writers would come up with an original idea once in a while instead of constantly putting me through this garbage. And you just reach a point where there's been too many broken hearts, too many sailors giving me the eye, too many conversations with raccoons, that finally something snaps, and you say, no more, no more. The next writer who has me in a buckskin miniskirt running through all the damn bushes, knee-high in poison ivy, will be in deep fucking shit. There is a pause of silence. Pocahontas realizes that she's gone out of character and becomes embarrassed. Oh, I'm sorry. Must have been something I ate. All right, any comments or questions? Praise, damnation? Or does everybody know everything? Do you speak English?
I have one question.
Yes, ma'am.
So, what's your favorite part of the Berlin Blues?
My favorite part of the Berlin Blues? No, I've been told, when we workshopped it and it premiered in Los Angeles, everybody down there and everybody I've met so far tells me their favorite character's trailer.
Yeah, of course.
And when we were doing, if somebody once down there said, if this ever gets made into a series, you've got to make trailer the central character. So I like trailer in the first act when he's so naive and simple, and then in the second act when he gets tainted, he becomes a little less lovable. So I guess when trailer's trying, somewhere in the first act, just trailer, period. And then as he sort of suddenly realizes what's going on, because I mean, he said the whole thing with the broken water pump, right? How he survives by brushing his teeth in pickle brine and having a Ryan Coke from Coke left over from his cereal. So yeah, I'd have to say that's my favorite part of the Berlin Blues. Yes?
I guess an obvious question is, has all of this humor and writing and the plays, has it helped the situation somewhat? Are things a little bit better today, a little more adjusted in the view of...
Oh, I think it's way better than it was in 1986 when we all started. I mean, native humor, native anything popular was a contradiction in terms, an oxymoron. Now, the writing voice is so entrenched in the Native community now that we're starting to do things that we wouldn't have considered years ago. I'm writing science fiction. Yeah. A couple years ago, I adapted and Indianized a Bertolt Brecht Kurt Weill musical. There's all sorts. I'm working on a sitcom in the next couple months. So what was once sort of like, who ever heard of a Native sitcom? But I'm working on my second one. So yeah, it's there's so much more room for expression out there. I don't know if anybody here has ever been to Prince Edward Island and the Charlottetown Festival, where they do, for 40 years they've done Anne of Green Gables. They've commissioned me to write them a full-scale musical, science fiction, eco-based fantasy. So I'm working on that right now. So yeah, the sky's the limit. It's so much fun out there now. Yes, ma'am.
In the tribes before 1500, or did the Europeans bring the business of prostitution with them?
Well, they say it's the oldest profession in the world, and I think prostitution as we know it now was not around then. So that's a tough question because I wasn't there. It's the oldest profession, but I really don't have an accurate answer for that on how it would have been done back then, on the commerce level of it. So I really can't answer that. Sorry. Yes, ma'am.
My question would be, what is more present in the Canadian community? Because I think that over here, one would think of the typical picture of an Indian as sexy, because all the Western media draws this picture, but in the beginning you said in Canada it's more like you think of the STDs and the prostitutes and
That's what's reported in a news constantly. The only mention of Native sexuality is that. It's never anything positive.
But what is more present in the people's mind? What do you think? Is it more?
In the people's mind, I see that's what's present, I think, in a dominant culture's mind. I mean, much like I said before, with humor, we knew we were funny, we know we're sexy. And nobody else did, really, other than, and maybe in the grossest kind of possible way. Right now, we have a lot of beautiful actors and actresses who are on television, sort of showing positive reinforcement of who they are and what they could be, and that one of the big problems in the Native community now is obesity, because of the change in diets and the high levels of carbohydrates and sugars. You know, on the west coast of Canada, amongst the Haida, they had no carbohydrates. They had one plant, which was a type of tuber, that they had to dig up. Everything else was almost protein. And so nowadays, my mother, my grandmother, 43% of my family was diabetic. And I mean, I'm bringing, sort of, there's a point to me bringing this up, for the fact that because of the change in diet, a lot of Native people have gotten overweight because we can't process carbs. And so there's a big health kick trying to get us back to the way our bodies were supposed to be meant and are supposed to be. And so there's this thing back and forth between, you know, buying into the dominant culture's myth that thin is beautiful, but diabetes isn't. So trying to find that middle ground, if that makes any sense. Yeah.
You were saying that in the beginning, when you started reading all the plays, rape was the dominant theme. And I was just wondering, is that still so, or has that phase, in quotation marks, passed?
It's lessened. It has lessened. The number one story that's coming out now are residential schools.
Okay.
I'm on the Dominion Institute of Canada, which is this organization that is set up to help foster and develop a knowledge and a love and an interest in Canadian history. They have a contest every year called the Aboriginal Writing Challenge, where they get submissions from 14 to 19 year olds and 20 to 24 year olds to write short stories or essays. I'm on a jury, and 3/4 of the stuff that comes in is on residential schools. There's you heard of the Sundance Institute? Robert Redford Sundance Institute? They have a special window, whatever, for Aboriginal scripts. And I remember talking with the guy who runs it, and he was saying, if I see one more script about residential schools, I'll kill myself. So that seems to be where the flavor is now. And unfortunately, the thing with residential schools is rape, sexual abuse of children. Look at the blonde Indian.
How about the fun question? Who's your sexiest character?
Who's my sexiest? Oh, I think it's John.
No.
It's from my book, Motorcycles and Streetgrass. I was asked about the growing styles of Aboriginal writing. My very first novel, I decided I wanted. I don't know if you guys have studied the concept of cultural appropriation. It used to be a big literary, socio-political issue in Canada, and that's when non-Native writers would write Native stories. And as one Native writer said, we'd steal our voices. So that has sort of gone by now. But I wanted to sort of reverse it, and I wanted to take a European legend and indigenize it. So I wrote a Native vampire novel. That was my first novel. My second novel, I wanted to take a traditional Native legend and contemporize it. Now, that's the novel we're talking about, Motorcycles and Sweetgrass, where the trickster, Nanabush, from Ojibway mythology, suddenly shows up on a contemporary Native reserve with long blonde hair, blue eyes that change color, and riding a vintage 1953 Indian Chief motorcycle and setting all the women's hearts aflutter and getting into mischief, as only the trickster can. So I think he's my sexiest character. Aside from my autobiographical stuff.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
What are your thoughts on cultural appropriation and Halloween costumes?
Every Halloween, I go up in a three-piece suit. As a white guy. I've never been asked that. Cultural appropriate. The question is, how do I feel about cultural appropriation at Halloween, with Halloween costumes? And that's a very good question. I mean, Germany has this issue overall with cultural appropriation of Native issues. When my very first trip to Lüneburg, driving from the train station to my hotel, I passed, I don't forget if it was two or three teepees here in Lüneburg. One in her front yard. So I'm like looking at that going, should I be insulted? You know? It depends on the representation, because I've seen both positive and absolutely offensive representations of Native people. And, you know, whether it's Halloween or not, if it's an offensive representation, I won't like it. But if it's just, you know, dressing up as a Native person, I guess it's okay, as long as it's done with respect. Yes?
Which brings to mind a story you wrote in one of your funny, or maybe it was news, I think it was news. One of your trips to Michigan.
Yes.
Where you found this, where they have the secret room.
Oh, yeah.
Tell that story. That's an interesting.
I was the writer in residence at the University of Michigan. And there was a secret, I think American universities are famous for this. There was a secret club that you had to be invited to. I can't even pronounce it. It was some sort of Indian name, Michigamo or something like that. And basically, there was this room in the university that was done up with birch bark. There was a canoe hanging up there. There was like feathers and tomahawks all over. And it was one of these sort of faux Native clubs, that secret clubs. And when they had their meetings, their ceremonies, whatever, they would literally do a fake Indian chant. And there'd be open windows, and the whole campus, you could hear white people chanting pseudo-Native things, and it got to the point about, I think it was 15 years ago, that the Native population at the university objected, and I don't think they shut down the club, because I guess it's a private club or whatever, but it was moved off campus. But it was just sort of, white people. It's like we don't, you know, on reserve, we don't sit around in suits talking about the stock market. Yes?
In one lecture this semester, we talked about we wondered for whom the stories of Native people are. So who do you have more in mind when you are writing the stories?
Who do I think my audience is?
Or the Native ones?
Well, I always say, because I'm half Native and half white, it's for both. But, I mean, that's my quick, flippant answer. That's my quick, flippant answer, and it's also my true answer, because, you know, as a playwright, 90% of the people who go and see my plays are non-Native, and 90% of the people who buy my novels are non-Native. So, from that perspective, I'd like to think I'm opening a window or bridge that people can understand some of the nuances of Native life. One of the reviewers who read Motorcycle Sweetgrass said that she was surprised how much life on a reserve is like a small town anywhere else. You know, there are 630 Native communities across Canada, and one of the popular misconceptions is that they're all poverty-stricken and poor and dire state of existence, when in fact, you take 630 small towns anywhere in Canada, anywhere in Germany, and you'll have some that are poor and broken, and you'll have some that are rich and affluent, and some that are middle class, and that's the same with Native communities. My reserve is actually quite middle class. So what I try and do when I write is I try and illustrate, I guess, the similarities more than the differences between the two cultures. And I like to think if people can read English, they're my audience.
In that case, actually, I wonder if only 10% of your audience is Native. How was the Me Sexy received by the Native audience? Because then I would think that the non-native audience received it well.
I contacted, I think, 15 people to write essays, and two turned me down, only because they had other projects they wanted to work on more than that. And so the response was surprisingly overwhelming. Much like that elder said, it's about time you young people reclaimed your sexuality. Everybody, whenever I approached him, said, great. Joseph Boyden, I don't know if you've studied his work, he has an essay in there. And what was really funny, going back to the first book, was that of, I think, the 13 essays in there, 9 of the 13 are funny. And when I started off here, I said humor and sex, they go together. In this book, almost, and this was not a prerequisite of mine, they just came back this way, that when they wrote the essays, a lot of them were very, very funny. I mean, I told you about Thompson, about Lee Miracle, there's a whole bunch of different ways of looking at it in there. As I said, the response was overwhelmingly positive. And this is getting a little off topic, but I'm doing a third book now. In fact, I just got permission about a month ago. The problem was, after you do humor and sex, where do you go from there? me macrame? Me gardening? Or me pregnant? So the next book is actually, I decided to sort of start feeding upon myself. I decided to do a book on the Native artistic spirit, on what makes Native people create and what makes their art uniquely Native. And it's going to be everything from an essay from a traditional drummer to a guy who does, a Native Haida guy who does, am I saying this properly, manga, like that Japanese kind of art. To traditional dancing, to contemporary theater. It's going to be a mix of traditional and contemporary arts. And I'm going to get people to write on what motivates them as an individual and as a Native artist to do their art. And it's going to be called Me Artsy.
Drew Hayden Taylor. Throughout your talk, I've had this nagging feeling, and I'm certainly not the only one, I think, in this audience, that somehow I'm pursuing the wrong area of research. But anyway, this is a little keep cup from the Leuphana University. We are ecological, and it's filled with something that's not going to help the diabetes.
You did want another t-shirt.
And you saw the table there? This is a book table. How he rips apart.
Yes.
Excellent.
And there's a book table with some of Drew Hayden Taylor's works. And you're welcome to purchase some of them, all of them. You know, he doesn't want to take them back to Canada. And of course, he will sign them. He has wonderful things that he writes for. You know, beautiful women, blonde hair, dark hair. He doesn't
Creamy
care.
Creamy white bosoms.
Creamy white bosoms. So, you know, take your chance. One last thing. This was, as Maryann's pointed out, the last lecture in this semester's lecture series, Maple Leaf and Stars and Stripes. But we will see you back again here, not in the summer term, but in the winter term again, and with fantastic new talks and fantastic new authors. And Drew will probably be back in 1.5 years, but that's a long ways off. So have a safe trip home. Thank you all for attending. It was wonderful to have such a big audience. Thank you so much.